Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents And She Was by Jessica Verdi, narrated by Chloe Cannon. Chapter 1. Time slows. I sense everything. My breath is fast but steady, my calloused palm in its familiar curve around the racket's handle. I stare the ball down, unblinking, undeterred, and count the nanoseconds. Ready, eager, calculating. Finally, with a ferocious forehand stroke, I let out a grunt and connect strings to ball. I can almost hear the poor thing wailing in frustration as it sails away from me. Mary Shea, my training partner across the net, darts into position to volley it back. In moments like these, when I'm in the zone, my hair slick with sweat and my muscles thrumming, the only things that exist are the ball, the net, and the court, and the symbiotic relationship my body has with each. It doesn't matter if I'm playing against Mary or our coach, Bob, or no one at all except a steadfast, bruised wall. The rest of the planet tunes out to a distant static, my own thoughts dim to the lowest volume on the dial. On the court, there is no problem that isn't solved by hard work and determination. Mary and I keep the volley going. It's our third set. Match point. Advantage, me. If I score the next point, I win. I imagine I'm on the hard court at Arthur Ashe Stadium, going head-to-head with Serena Williams in the finals of the U.S. Open, the audience half cheering, half holding their breaths in suspense. Someday, I vow, I'll be there. Mary returns the ball close to the net, but I meet it easily and smash it, hard, back to her side. She shrieks as she dives for it, but she's too far away. The little yellow sphere bounces to the ground, unobstructed. Yes! I shout on the last of my air, lifting my racket high in triumph.
Very nice, both of you,
Bob calls from his trusty portable camping chair by the net post, where he's jotting in his notebook.
Damn, girl,
Mary says, holding her hand out to me. Even though it's just a practice match, we always shake before and after.
You too,
I say, gripping her sweaty palm across the net. That might have been one of our best matches ever. She shrugs.
Would have been better if I'd won.
I roll my eyes, out of routine more than irritation. Typical Mary. She likes to work hard and stretch her limits, which you'd think would mean she accepts that losing sometimes is part of the game. No point in practicing with an evenly matched opponent if you care only about winning. But no, she wants it all, every time. It can be hard watching Mary, the girl who has all the money and resources and support in the world, go off and play in pro tournaments, earning ranking points and making a name for herself on the circuit. Meanwhile, most days I'm at the local rec center in my middle-of-nowhere town in western New York State, hitting balls against a racquetball wall, my shoes squeaking against the wood floor, my teeth clenched in determination. Mary and I head over to the bench where our stuff is. Her chestnut hair is still pinned into its usual severe bun on the top of her head, with only the tiniest flyaways at her temples to hint at physical exertion. I don't know how she does it. By the end of a killer match, my wavy, shoulder-length blonde hair is always spilling out of its ponytail, more a stinky, tangled rat's nest than anything else. My pale skin is blotchy and absolutely dripping with sweat. Mary's tan skin is smooth and glistening like a lake on a sunny morning. I wipe my forehead and neck with my towel and take a long chug of water. I'm packing up my gear when Bob comes over. His apple cheeks are red and shiny, matching his bald head. Everything about Bob Nelson is round and glowing. He was a pro player from 1979 to 1985 and doesn't let me get away with not giving my best every single day.
For the winner.
He holds out a small, individually wrapped square of dark chocolate. I laugh and pop it in my mouth. Food is fuel and strength and brain power, so I try to be very careful about what I put in my body. I actually prefer lean proteins, dark, leafy greens, and whole grains to junk food. One reason of many why the kids at school and I seem to be from different planets. But I can never pass up one of Bob's little prizes. I figure if I bust my butt for a couple hours first,
The few extra grams of refined sugar are acceptable. You've made quite a bit of progress on your two-handed backhand, Dara. I'm impressed.
Thanks, I say, relieved. I've been working on that stroke a lot lately on the racquetball court. He claps me on the shoulder.
Listen, you took lots of risks today, kept up great momentum. I've never seen you this confident on the court. It's time to get out there.
Really? Suddenly, I seem to have gotten a second wind. I could dance around the court right now. I know what he means by out there. Bob wants me to go pro. And so do I. High school ended a week ago. It's time to start making my dreams a reality. Since the moment I could walk, maybe even before that, tennis has been my sole focus. I'll never forget sitting in the little seat compartment of a shopping cart at Target, pointing to a child-sized red plastic racket and wailing at the top of my lungs until my mom grudgingly agreed to buy it. Since then, everything else, schoolwork, social life, everything, has taken a back seat to my training. It's part of me. Because of tennis, I've never been to a pizza party or kissed a boy. Because of tennis, my relationship with my mother has been stretched, taxed, strained. Because of tennis, I know what it feels like to be proud. Because of tennis, I have an answer when people ask me who I am, despite all the other blank spaces in my life. It was all my choice, every time, the good and the bad. And now I can finally go after a professional tennis career. Almost. The one thing I don't have is money. And this sport requires a lot of it. Tennis club memberships are expensive, and so are training sessions. As it is, I have to drive an hour and a half each way every Tuesday and Friday to Rochester, because that's where the nearest tennis center is located, and where Bob and Mary live. I've won a little money in the few regional junior circuit tournaments I've been able to play in, and earned some more at my part-time job at the juice stand at the mall. But I've spent every dime on coaching and equipment. Bob cuts me a break on his fee because I always double up my sessions with Mary. She trains with him 6 days a week, 4 one-on-one sessions, and 2 with me. This has been our system for the past few years, and I'm equal parts grateful and jealous. Going pro is even pricier. When you're starting out, the tournaments don't pay much. The prize pools usually total around $10,000, and that's split among the top few finishers. So even if you win, you're not earning a real living. Plus, you have to pay for travel, accommodations, equipment, your trainer, and so on. It adds up fast. A lot of players, like Mary, are bankrolled by family money. That's not an option for me. My mom is a nurse. She works hard, taking overtime shifts at all hours of the day and night to ensure we make ends meet, but her paycheck isn't huge. And I have no dad to speak of, no extended family, no one else to ask.
There's an upcoming ITF women's tournament in Toronto,
Bob continues.
Mary's playing in it.
I know, I say. The International Tennis Federation circuit is where a professional tennis career begins. Ideally, I'd travel to as many tournaments as possible, in the U.S. and beyond, put my nose to the grindstone, and start earning ranking points. I'll work my way up to the Women's Tennis Association 125K series, continue earning points, and then, if all goes according to plan, eventually advance to the WTA Tour. That's the big one. The one where I could someday see Serena's face staring back at me from across the net. There's also one before that in Buffalo, a few in Florida, and one in Charlottesville, Virginia. I can recite the ITF schedule by heart. I should be signing up for as many as possible. Bob nods.
I understand finances are a concern.
He lowers his voice. I don't know why. Mary is perfectly aware of my situation. She's even alluded to being happy about it on occasion, because she knows if she had to play me, really play me, in a real match, she'd lose there too.
But starting slow is better than not starting at all. If there's any way you could make it happen, I think you should begin with the Toronto one in August. It's got a bigger prize pool than the others, so if you did well, which I'm confident you would, it could get you off to a great start.
That would be amazing. He levels me with his gaze.
Otherwise, Dara, what's the point of all this?
He waves a hand around us. His words punch the air out of me far more effectively than 2 hours of running around the court did. It was easier to pretend I had plenty of time to figure things out when school was still in session. But I need to make a move. Now. Or the Marys of the world are going to pass me by and Bob will have to move on to more serious players. Toronto, Canada. It's only a 3-hour drive from home, but it might as well be the moon. I've never been out of the country. I've barely even left this little pocket of upstate New York. Seeing what else is out there has always been on my to-do list, but so far, it hasn't been an option. Mary's dad arrives then, and Bob excuses himself to give Mr. Shea the rundown on today's session. I take a quick shower in the tennis center's swanky locker room, run a comb through my hair, and throw on a clean pair of leggings and a tank top. My body feels good, clean, and tired in the best way. But as I leave the building, my head is murky with half plans.
Hey,
a familiar voice says, and I look up to see my friend Sam jogging down the sidewalk toward me. His camera bounces against his chest. My face muscles relax instantly. Sam Alapati and I have been best friends since Mom and I moved into the house next to his in Francis, New York, when I was 3. Apart from my mom, he's the most important person in my life. It didn't take long for the kids at school to grow impatient with my training schedule and stop inviting me to things, and I'm not sure if Mary would be my friend if not for tennis. But Sam's different. He exists in his own realm. What are you doing here? I ask him.
I spent the morning at the Eastman Museum, and then I remembered that you're in the city on Tuesdays, too. But I guess I'm too late to get to watch you play.
You watch me hit balls in the backyard all the time, I say.
That's not the same.
True. Mary comes out of the building then with her dad.
See you next time, Dara,
Mr. Shea says. He's a really nice guy, genuinely proud of his daughter and willing to give her whatever she needs to achieve her goals. And I don't just mean financially. He and Ms. Shea are always at Mary's tournaments, cheering her on from the stands.
Yep, see ya,
I say. Mary lays eyes on Sam and automatically smooths the 2 stray hairs back into her bun.
Oh, hi, Sam. I didn't know you were here.
I resist the urge to make barf sounds. Sam is cute, I guess, with his dark brown skin, messy brown hair, and easy smile. But I don't see him that way. He and Mary met a couple months ago at a junior tournament, the last time Sam saw me play. I never knew Mary was the gushing type until I saw her fall all over herself to meet him. She didn't seem to care that he'd brought his then-girlfriend, Sarah, quick. Sam broke up with Sarah just before graduation because, he said, it was pointless for them to keep pretending like everything was normal when they were about to go to college in different states. Secretly, I was happy, because now he and I get to spend the summer together, Sarah free. But I wonder if Sam will pick up what Mary's offering, now that he's single.
Hi, Mary. How are you?
He says politely. And I know immediately that I'm safe from having to spend the last summer before he goes away to school watching him make out with my best frenemy.
I'm doing well. I have 5 tournaments lined up for the summer already.
Sam's eyes dart to me in sympathy, and then back to her.
That's really cool. I'm sure you'll do great.
She beams.
Are you headed to college in the fall?
He nods.
Massachusetts College of Art and Design.
His dream photography school. They chat about that for a minute, and as I watch them talk, these 2 people who are about to get everything they've ever wanted, the sudden need to get out of here takes hold of me.
Did you drive in, Sam?
I interrupt. He shakes his head.
Bus.
I make a follow me gesture with my head. Cars parked around the corner. We should get going if we want to beat rush hour traffic.
Okay,
he says.
Bye, Mary. Bye, Mary's dad.
We get in the car, and as I drive, Sam scrolls through the photos he took at the museum. What do you think about me signing up for a pro tournament in Canada? I ask after a few miles, cutting into the silence and mundaneness of this well-traveled road. He looks up from his camera.
Really?
Yeah, Bob brought it up today. He thinks I'm ready.
Dara, that's awesome.
Sam knows how important Bob's opinion is to me, but it only takes half a beat for him to catch on to my lack of enthusiasm.
Aren't you excited?
I glance at him. Of course I'm excited. You know how long I've been working toward this.
I do.
But he knows.
Yeah.
He clicks off his camera, then asks quietly,
Have you mentioned it to Melly?
Not yet.
What his question really means? How are you going to get your mom to agree to it? Because it's not just the money issue that makes this a touchy subject for her.
Mom's never been excited or invested in my career. When I try to share news about progress I've made in a training session, she says minimally encouraging things with no real emphasis behind them, or just changes the subject completely. It's not a good feeling, knowing the person closest to you doesn't support the thing most important to you. Any suggestions on how to bring it up? I ask Sam. This conversation about Toronto is going to be crucial. I have to figure out how to get her on my side, not drive the wedge in further. And Sam knows my mom almost as well as I do. His mom, Nia, is best friends with my mom.
Ease into the subject casually, you know?
Sam suggests.
Don't give her a chance to put up her defenses.
While Sam thinks, sometimes out loud, sometimes not, I exit the highway and drive past all the totally thrilling, all too familiar Francis landmarks, two churches and a temple, the few vegetable-covered tables in the parking lot of Dr. Fred's dentist office, our version of a farmer's market, the two-pump gas station, the McDonald's.
What if you ask her about getting a passport?
Sam asks finally.
You'll need one if you're going to Canada. And it won't be like, oh, hey, Mom, let's talk about tennis.
A passport, I repeat, mulling it over. It's not a bad idea.
I will need one, for this tournament and hopefully other international ones in the future.
She won't be able to disagree that I should have one in case of emergencies or whatever, right? He nods. How do you even get a passport? Do you need to go into City Hall or something? I ask.
I think you can do it at the post office. I remember I had to bring my birth certificate.
Which means I'll need to track down my birth certificate. When I went to apply for my learner's permit, the DMV lady asked for it, but we hadn't brought it with us, so Mom signed some sort of statement of identity thing for me instead. Still, she must have my birth certificate somewhere. Okay, so I start with telling her I need a passport, and then, once the discussion is going well, I'll veer into the specifics of the Toronto tournament. I elbow Sam.
You're so smart.
He smiles.
Aren't you glad I mooched a ride off you now?
I laugh. When I pull into my driveway, Sam unclicks his seatbelt and opens the door.
Good luck.
Thanks, I say, but make no move to get out of the car. I watch as he crosses the lawn to his house, scanning through his photos once more. He doesn't watch where he's going, but there's no need. We could both do the path between our houses blindfolded. I bat my fingertips against the steering wheel a few quick times in an attempt to get fired up. Then I get out of the car and jog up to our little yellow house.
Heya!
Mom calls from the kitchen when I swing open the squeaky screen door.
How was practice?
I drop my bag in the foyer and round the corner. She's in her light pink scrubs, her brown hair in a swingy ponytail, sitting at the kitchen table clipping coupons from the grocery store circular. I can't believe paper coupons are still a thing. You'd think they'd have moved to apps with scannable barcodes or something by now. But Mom loves searching through the papers, finding good sales, and organizing her coupons in her Velcro coupon pouch. It was really good, I say. Normally, I'm happy when she asks about practice, but today I kinda wish she hadn't, so I could have started with the passport stuff like Sam and I planned.
Glad to hear it.
She doesn't pause in her task. A sealed package rests on the counter. I recognize the box immediately, and it's like a railroad switch, the only thing that could get me to veer onto a different track right now. Hot sauce king, I cry. I grab the box and bring it to the table.
That gets Mom to put her scissors down.
Her eyes light up.
I was waiting for you to open it. What do you think? Wait until fajita night tomorrow, or taste test now?
Taste test now! I grab the scissors and slice through the packing tape. Mom gets up and grabs 6 teaspoons from the silverware drawer. A deep respect and admiration for spicy food is one quality Mom and I share unreservedly. A few times a year, we order new hot sauces online and have a tasting party. There are 3 bottles inside. Knock You on Your Butt Spicy Sauce, Firemouth Habanero, and Chef Jose's What Doesn't Kill You Makes You Stronger. I've been wanting to try that last one for a long time. Mom and I make quick work of opening the bottles and pouring a small amount of each into the teaspoons. When they've all been doled out, we each pick up the Knock You on Your Butt and face off like we're going to thumb wrestle. Ready? She asks. I was born ready. 1, 2, 3. We spoon the sauce into our mouths. My eyes immediately water, and Mom forces herself to swallow before breaking into a surprised cough. Holy crap! I croak. That's a 9 at least, she says, taking a giant gulp of water. Rookie move. Water doesn't do much to cool your mouth in times like these. Laughing, I go to the fridge and pour us each a big glass of almond milk. I take a sip, smack my lips, and say, 8. We always rank the sauces on a scale of 1 to 10. When our palates have sufficiently recovered, we move on to the Firemouth Habanero. We both agree this one is probably about a 5, though someone with a weaker constitution would probably give these all a 10. The What Doesn't Kill You Makes You Stronger is way more up my alley. I give it a 9. Mom, a 10. I don't know why I love the sensation that my taste buds are burning a fiery death, but I do. We're ordering more of that one next time, I say, tossing the spoons in the dishwasher. Definitely. She slips her coupon pouch into her purse, grabs her insulated lunch bag from its hook on the pantry door, and starts pulling sandwich fixings from the fridge, a telltale sign she's about to start a shift. She works in the ER and doesn't always get to take an official dinner break. So Nia was telling me about this new movie she and Ramesh just watched. It's a documentary about a guy who had to get his leg amputated but kept it, in a grill of all places. And then the grill was sold and the new owner found the leg and refused to give it back. She grins over her shoulder. We should watch that one night next week if you're free. Sure, I say. Maybe Monday after I get home from the juice stand? Works for me. It's easy hanging out with her like this. Our relationship is like a coin, and these are what I call head-side moments. Both our schedules are nuts, and we don't always spend as much time together as we'd like. But we do make sure to set aside time for our traditions. Puzzles together on the front porch when the weather is nice, Netflix on lazy nights, going out to restaurants for special occasions and ordering the spiciest things on the menu, occasional homemade dinners with Sam and his family. I know if I'm ever in trouble, Mom will be there for me. We're a team. Not quite a doubles team, where everything one of us does depends on the other, but more like singles players representing the same country in the Olympics, a team in which the members operate independently but with a shared goal. But I know the second I broach the topic of the passport and Toronto, the coin is going to flip. And the tail side is a completely different story. A wall goes up between me and Mom, and we might both still be competing in the Olympics, but we're bitter rivals. Sometimes this happens when the subject of the past comes up. She doesn't like talking about her family or where she came from, and she always shuts down in those moments. But the main thing that sends the wall up is tennis. Mom has absolutely no faith that my tennis career is going to happen. For a long time, she humored me and drove me to practice as if it were just another mom job like doctor's office visits and parent-teacher conferences. But lately, anytime the subject of my going pro comes up, she goes on the offensive, saying it's too expensive or unrealistic. I actually think she's hoping I'll fail so she'll be able to insist I go to college in a year. She had to go to work right after high school, and she wants me to have the education, the opportunities she never had. And yes, in lots of ways, it makes sense to play tennis at the collegiate level. Mom would be happy I was continuing my academic career, and I'd be happy to have regular sessions on the court. The school could finance a lot of my tennis expenses. Plenty of pros played in college. It's a viable path to the majors, for sure. Except for the tiny fact that it doesn't feel right. I've never been a very dedicated student. I don't think I ever got higher than a B- in anything except phys ed. The court was always my classroom. Training was my brand of studying. Commencement never meant a beginning. It meant the end of my biggest distraction. While Sam and most of the other kids in our year were obsessing over transcripts and portfolios and letters of recommendation this past fall, I didn't apply to a single college. I'm done with school and can finally focus on the important stuff. So why on earth would I go back? I grab an apple from the basket on the windowsill, spin it around to remove the stem, and watch Mom as she drops a handful of baby carrots into a baggie. I don't want to flip the coin. I don't want this good moment to come to an end. But I have to. It's too important. I take a deep breath and segue into the line I'd practiced in the car with Sam. I'm going to apply for a passport next week. Would you mind digging up my birth certificate when you get a chance? I'll need it for the application. Like a sponge being zapped of its moisture, Mom's entire body goes rigid. The baggie of baby carrots slips from her fingers to the counter. One of the little orange nubs rolls into the sink. Really? Already? I didn't even mention the word tennis. What's wrong? I ask, the lingering hot sauce on my tongue turning sour.
Nothing.
She turns to face me. Her expression is hard to read, unlined but oddly tense. If I didn't have so much practice spotting and analyzing abrupt actions in short bursts of time, I'd miss the swift lick of her lips, the extra beat she takes to make sure there's no emotion in her voice.
What do you need a passport for?
Well, I take a realigning moment of my own. Forget the ease or intuit strategy, just say it. Now that school's over, Bob and I agree it's time to start entering pro tournaments. I know we've talked about how it's not possible, but I think I need to make it possible. The only way I'm ever going to reach the majors is if I start earning ranking points now. I can't stay in Francis forever.
Most 18-year-olds go off to college when they want to get away from their hometown,
Mom says under her breath. I ignore it. I know money is tight, but I'll take more shifts at work and then use that money for travel. I'll subsidize it with credit cards if I have to. The most important thing is playing, getting the experience, getting my name out there, and getting ranked. The corners of her mouth have turned down. I keep going. There are some tournaments in the States coming up, but Bob said it would be smart to begin with the one in Toronto in August. I pause briefly. That's where the passport comes in. She takes the apple from where I abandoned it on the table and carefully puts it back in its basket. Everything in its place. What do you think? I ask finally. She looks at me. A flash of sadness floods her eyes, but then it quickly subsides, like the changes of a tide sped up on a time-lapse video.
I don't see how it can work, Dara.
My heart drops. This is so unfair. Why can't she even try to see it from my point of view? Why not? I ask flatly.
First of all, how are you going to both take on more shifts at the juice stand and travel so much? There are only so many hours in the day. Believe me, I know.
Well, I won't be traveling all the time. Each tournament is only 6 days. I could...
Secondly, please don't put any of this on your credit card. Those bills accumulate faster than you can imagine, and the interest rates are outrageous. I've worked very hard to keep us out of debt. Credit cards are for...
Emergencies only, I mumble. Yeah, I know. This is not the first time I've heard this speech. But doesn't she understand that this feels like an emergency to me? She checks the clock on the microwave.
I have to go.
She grabs her lunch bag, but stops before leaving the kitchen and pulls me into a hug. I don't back away, but I don't relax into it either.
I'm proud of you, Dara. We just need to be more... realistic.
She ruffles my hair and leaves the room. No. She doesn't get to just shut me down like this. She doesn't get to pretend like she cares and then walk out the door, leaving me stuck and alone. Not again. I run after her. Can I at least have my birth certificate so I can get my passport? Maybe I do have to come up with a better plan, but when I do, I want to be ready to go. Her hand is on the screen door latch, and she only turns halfway back. She doesn't look me in the eye.
I'm sorry. I don't know where it is.
With that, she leaves.
Chapter 2. I stare at the screen door as it groans shut. She lost my birth certificate? Or does she just not want to give it to me? Fury burns hot through my veins. I'm 18. I don't have to listen to her. I can do what I want. If I want to rack up $1 million in credit card debt, that's my own damn prerogative. Once Mom's car disappears down the road, I spin on my heel and march straight to her desk in the dining room. Pay stubs, old report cards, checkbook, tax documents. No birth certificate. I go to the living room and pull my baby book off the bookshelf. A few photos of me as a baby, an inked footprint, a lock of hair from my first haircut. No birth certificate. Where else could it be? I worry my bottom lip with my teeth, a bad habit that tends to show up when I'm unsure about something. There's no clutter in this house, no secret places it could be hiding. For someone who doesn't spend much time at home, Mom sure loves cleaning the place. From the hints I've managed to eke out about her past, I know her parents were abusive, and she moved out after high school and never spoke to them again. And as for my father, turns out knowing someone's last name isn't a prerequisite for him to get you pregnant. I think it brings Mom a feeling of peace, of control, to keep the house in perfect order. But that just makes it even more unbelievable that she really doesn't know where my birth certificate is. My legs start moving again, this time toward Mom's room. Her nightstand contains books, a book light, an economy-sized bottle of moisturizer, and some lip balm. No documents of any kind. I swipe the lip balm and glide a healthy coat on my chewed, cracked lips, then put it back. Her dresser drawers are filled with folded squares of underwear, t-shirts, jeans, and scrubs. Her closet is neatly arranged with shoes in cubbies, coats and dresses on hangers. I drop to my stomach and use the flashlight on my phone to check under the bed. Orderly boxes of winter clothes. I'm about to stand back up when the flashlight beam glints off something small and shiny at the back next to the wall. I shimmy closer, my hair clinging to the staticky underside of the bed's box spring, and stretch to reach the object. When my fingertips graze the surface, my pulse beats a triumphant little staccato. Jackpot! The light had caught on the metal of a small lock, and the lock is latched onto a safe deposit box-looking thing. There's no way my birth certificate isn't in there. I slide out from under the bed, bringing the box with me, and push my hair away from my face. I sit back on my heels and try to pull the lid open. The lock is secure. The empty keyhole yawns at me like a bored kid in church. The first question that comes to mind, where is the key? And then the second, why would Mom have a locked box under her bed at all? God knows we don't have any valuables that would need to be kept safe from potential robbers. I don't think I've ever even heard of there being a burglary in this town anyway. What could she possibly be hiding? My mother isn't the most open person in the world, but she's also pretty basic. Work, sleep, once upon a time on Sunday nights, repeat. I do another search through the house, this time for a key, a small one that might fit in the lock of a mysterious secret box. I check all the logical places first, desk and kitchen drawers, the tops of bookshelves, the miscellaneous basket near the refrigerator. Then I look in the illogical places, the toes of boots, the zippered opening and throw pillows, the ice bin in the freezer. I'm beginning to think either the key doesn't exist or Mom has it with her at the hospital when, on my third sweep through her room, I find it. I blink a few times to make sure it's really there and not just a trick of my tired eyes. It's small and silver and nestled comfortably under the bottle of moisturizer on her nightstand, smiling pleasantly up at me, like I'm an idiot. I'd laugh if this whole day wasn't so frustrating. Sitting on the floor of my mom's bedroom, this has to be the most time I've ever spent in here, I slip the key into the lock and turn. It clicks, and I lift the lid. The box is very full. On the top of the pile are two small prescription bottles. I don't recognize the names of the meds, but they're both in Mom's name, and the filled date is only a few weeks ago. She didn't tell me she was sick. And why wouldn't she just put the medicine in the kitchen where we keep the rest of our pharmacy stuff? Why would she lock it away? Oh, God.
She isn't sick, is she? What if she has cancer? What if she's been dealing with this all alone because she didn't want to scare me and was waiting to tell me the truth until she got her official prognosis? What if that's the reason she doesn't want me to go pro? Because she might need someone to take care of her. My skin prickles as the image of Mom not being here anymore invades my mind. She's all I have. I grab my phone and begin to dial her cell. Whatever happens, I'm here for you, I want to say to her. Nothing's more important than this. But a dose of rationale trickles in, and before I hit the green call button, I switch over to the internet browser and look up the names of the medications. Huh. One is an estrogen replacement. The other is a testosterone blocker. So, not cancer? Looks like she has some sort of hormonal imbalance I didn't know about. Maybe she's gone into early menopause. That could explain why she's been so cranky lately. My breathing returns to normal as the panic seeps from my body. She's fine. Everything's fine. I wish she didn't feel like she has to shelter me from this stuff. I'm not a little kid anymore. I can handle it. I place the bottles on the carpet and return to the box's contents. It's mostly papers. I shuffle through, looking for something that might be a birth certificate. It feels kind of wrong to be snooping in here, going through all of Mom's personal stuff. I already know about one thing she didn't want me to. At this point, I just want to find what I came for and be done with it. Toward the bottom of the pile of documents, I find it. New York State Certification of Birth. Yes! First step toward getting my passport and my freedom complete. But as I skim the information on the document, my celebration drifts into confusion. My first name, middle name, and birth date are correct, but nothing else makes sense. The child's name is listed as Dara Ruth Hogan. That's not my name. My name is Dara Ruth Baker. And the parents' names. Not only are there two of them, when Mom always swore she didn't know my father's name, but neither of them is Mom. Father's name, Marcus Hogan. Mother's maiden name, Celeste Margaret Pembroke. Where is Melly Baker? I stare at the paper. It shivers in my wavering grasp, but no matter how many times I read the words on the page, no logical explanation comes. I don't understand what I'm looking at. The only thing I know for sure is that she never planned on me seeing this. I take every last item from the box, spread them out on the carpet, and begin to read. With each photo and document, the disquiet in my stomach becomes sharper, jagged. A wedding announcement for Marcus Hogan and Celeste Pembroke from just months before I was born. An old, worn issue of Sports Illustrated that falls open to a half-page feature on men's tennis up-and-comers. The names mentioned include Marcus Hogan. And dozens of pictures I've never seen before of two people and a chubby-armed baby. There's no question, the baby is me. I recognize myself from the pictures in the baby book, and I still have that dimple under my left eye when I smile. Mom's not in a single photo. I sit back a little, force myself to take 5 breaths. Then carefully I reach for the photos, study them. They span at least 6 months. Mushy newborn up through the start of the cute drooling phase. They were taken in different locations at different times of year, and I'm always with the same two people, a man and a woman. No one else. No Mom. The man is clean-shaven with shaggy light brown hair and blue eyes. There's something about his smile that is familiar, but I don't think I've seen him before. The woman has long, wavy blonde hair, pink lips, and cheeks. She looks so much like me, right down to the dimple, that it takes my breath away. She's only in the earliest photos. In the ones where I'm a little older, it's just me and the man, always grinning and happy, opening gifts in front of the Christmas tree, on the swings at a park, petting puppies at some sort of rescue dog adoption event, and bouncing balls at a tennis court. Marcus Hogan was listed as the father on my birth certificate. Marcus Hogan was, according to the magazine article, a tennis player. These pictures have to be of him, and the woman must be Celeste Pembroke. But who are they? I throw everything back into the box, not bothering to be neat or careful about it. The lid makes an almost satisfying clunk when I slam it down. I don't lock it. Instead, I carry the box, the lock, and the key to the living room, place them on the coffee table, and glower at them from my seat on the sofa a few feet away. The clock on the mantel ticks steadily. One by one, possibilities, crazy, impossible possibilities, bleed into me. There are only two explanations I can think of right now. Both bad, one worse than the other. The two options continue to take shape, but to do so, they have to borrow and steal from everything I previously knew to be true. It's not possible for the old and the new to coexist and remain intact. A bend here, an erasure there. As I sit, trying to keep calm, my entire past, my entire life, is crumbling apart. I get up, begin to move, slowly at first, then as fast as my bare feet will carry me, through the room, out the front door, across the lawn. I don't want to be alone right now. Chapter 3. I don't need to knock. Being welcome at this blue house any day, any time, has been a constant, something that was decided long before I can remember. What else was decided before your memories begin?
Hey, Dara!
Nia calls out cheerfully from the dining room. She's setting the table for dinner, complete with the colorful little chutney bowls I love so much. A gardening podcast is piping through the stereo, and the house is rich with the scent of Ramesh's famous masala sauce. Sam's dad was born in India and brought all his mother's recipes with him when he moved to the U.S. to go to college. Nia's of Indian descent, too, but she's lived here her whole life. I lift a hand in greeting as I make my way downstairs to Sam's room, but I don't say anything. I don't trust myself to. There's too much going on in my head, and I don't know what will come out. Nia is Mom's best friend. What if she knows Mom's been lying to me? What if all those times we sat around that dining room table eating malai kofta or tandoori chicken or mushroom pizza from the one pizza place in town, she and Mom were holding a silent exchange about how pitifully clueless I was? Or what if she doesn't know, and I arouse suspicion in her, too, without even having a foothold on what's going on myself? I just need to get to Sam. He's focusing so intently on his computer screen that he doesn't notice when I appear in the entrance to his bedroom. His a little too long to be called short hair has fallen in his face, and his fingers move skillfully over the trackpad. Sam works with photographs, but he's more than a photographer. He takes pictures, uploads them onto his computer, and then Photoshops them. Not the lame kind of Photoshop where stick figure models are made even skinnier or a zit on the chin of some movie star is erased. Sam uses Photoshop to make art. He plays with our expectations, our preconceived notions of what's normal, and turns them on their head. So something in the photo is off, but at first glance, it looks like nothing's amiss. You have to stare a minute to figure out why you feel so unsettled. And then you see it. The apples on a tree are actually mini pumpkins. A person's smiling mouth has been flipped upside down. It's really cool. I've asked him to make a piece for me a million times, but he always said it doesn't work that way. He needs to wait to be inspired. He can't force it. Still, he's given his art to his parents, his sister, Anita, and Sarah Quick. I never understood why he could be inspired for them, but not for me. Especially Sarah. Sam admitted once that Sarah was jealous of me, though I can't for the life of me figure out why. I should have been the one who was jealous of her, the way she got to take up all his time, and inspired a Sam Alapati original, a seascape with light pink seagulls that I only got to see once before it was relegated to Sarah's bedroom wall. Jealous of how easy school was for her, and how she made friends everywhere she went. She was the valedictorian and the homecoming queen. Sam's had a few girlfriends, but the Sarah relationship was the longest so far, about a year. She had zero reason to be jealous of me. Hey, I say. My voice sounds strained. The unthinkable thoughts are fighting their way to my mouth. It won't be long before I lose the battle. I close the door. He looks up and quickly snaps his laptop closed.
Hey, how did the talk with...
Once he gets a good look at me... His face falls,
What's wrong?
I sit on his bed and hug my knees.
Dara?
The crazy is dancing around on my tongue now. I'll let the more reasonable possibility out first. If Sam agrees it's feasible or even likely, I won't ever have to voice the other one. You haven't heard our moms talking about me being adopted, have you?
Adopted?
He says. I nod.
Like, Melly's not your birth mom?
I nod again.
No chance,
he says right away.
If you were adopted, she would have told you. Why would she hide it?
What he's saying makes sense, I know. Adoption is normal. If I were adopted, Mom would have shown me the pictures long ago and explained about my birth parents and wouldn't have had to make up a lie about a one-night stand. It doesn't add up. The scarier option finds its way to my throat. I swallow it back.
Dara, what happened? Where is this coming from?
I clear my throat. You were right. He's confused.
About what?
Remember how the yearbook staff asked everyone in the senior class to contribute a baby picture, and I only had the few from my baby book to choose from? And you said that was weird, considering how many photos of me as an older kid Mom keeps around the house. I'd never realized this until Sam pointed it out. But when I asked Mom about it, she told me that when we moved to the house in Francis, the movers lost a few boxes and the photo albums and scrapbooks were in one of them. Most of the pictures from my early childhood and the pictures from Mom's life before me, all gone. And it wasn't like she could ask her estranged parents for copies. Sam told me there should be digital backups of them somewhere, but Mom seemed so sad about the pictures being lost that I didn't press her on it. Now, though, as a parade of red flags marches before my eyes, I know I should have asked. You were right, I say again. Those weren't the only baby pictures she had of me. I take another breath. I found something today. He uses his heels to wheel his chair closer to me. When he reaches the edge of the bed, he leans forward, forearms on his thighs, and says, softly,
"Tell me."
I chew on my lip. I'm actually glad, in a twisted way, for the opportunity to recount the inexplicable insanity of what I found and how I found it. Because if my mouth is filled with all these words, then the scariest possibility of all can't find a way out. Yet. I go through the whole story, describing every picture, the people, the birth certificate, everything. It's not hard. Each item from that box is emblazoned on my memory.
Huh,
he says when I'm finished. I stare at him. Wait for more. It doesn't come. That's it? Huh?
Sorry, I don't really know what to say.
Doesn't it seem like adoption could be a possibility?
Melly wouldn't have kept that secret from you.
Well, clearly she was keeping something secret from me. I snap. He looks at me warily. I let out a harsh sigh. Fine. What do you think it is, then?
I have no idea.
There's silence for a minute. I'd hoped he would be able to help. See something I didn't. An explanation so obvious, so boring, it passed me by unnoticed. But now he's going to make me say it. The scarier thought. I can't keep it in anymore. Sam, do you think I was kidnapped? It's absurd. Utterly impossible. Mom isn't capable of something like that. But the pictures, the name change, Marcus and Celeste, they have to mean something. And it's the only other thing I can think of that fits. My heart is pounding as I wait for his answer. Then he does the last thing I expect. He starts to laugh. A lot. Loud, rolling laughter. Sam! I hit his arm. This is serious!
Kidnapped? This isn't Dateline.
The only reason Dateline is even a thing is because this kind of stuff happens, I counter. And no one on that show ever thought it would happen to them.
Sam is still laughing. No way. You're not adopted and you were not kidnapped. You're definitely Melly's daughter.
How can you be so sure?
You have a lot in common. You're both independent and driven. You both really like spicy food, more than anyone else I've met.
That proves nothing.
Okay, then your eyes.
They're the same as Millie's.
Lots of people have blue eyes. We don't really look alike in any other way.
You make similar expressions sometimes.
Learned behavior, I shoot back. And what about the woman in the pictures? She looked just like me, Sam.
Maybe she's a relative? Maybe your mom has a sister.
She does, I say slowly, considering it. She's older.
I asked my mom once why she decided to become a nurse, and she said it was because she and her sister used to play hospital with their dolls when they were little, and it was one of her only good memories from her childhood.
Her name is Josie? Joanne? Something like that.
There you go. Maybe they kept in touch back then.
I shake my head. I'm pretty sure the woman in the photos is Celeste Pembroke.
Why? Sam asks. Is she wearing a name tag in any of them?
Of course not. But Celeste Pembroke is the name of my mother on my birth certificate. And those pictures are pretty clearly of parents with their daughter. Plus, Marcus Hogan was a tennis player, and there are pictures of the man and me on a tennis court. So if he's Marcus, she's got to be Celeste. And all that aside, if Mom knew these people, if it really was her sister or whatever, Mom would have been in the pictures too.
She could have been taking the photos?
He doesn't sound convinced, though. All of them? She didn't want to be in a single picture with her own baby? I don't buy it. Sam's lack of response is proof of his agreement. The room goes quiet again. The sounds of Nia's gardening podcast travel through the ceiling. A chill, defiant of the summer heat and the lack of AC in Sam's room, passes over my skin.
Okay, there is one other possibility,
he finally says.
Hopefully it's one that trumps kidnapping.
What?
Maybe you lived with other people when you were a baby. Maybe Melly had you, but then gave you to those people for a little while, and she was too ashamed about it to tell you.
No, the birth certificate, Sam. She wasn't listed as my parent.
Oh, yeah.
I really don't think she gave birth to me, I say quietly. The need for answers tightens its chokehold on me. I have to confront Mom. And to think that just this afternoon I was nervous to start a conversation about tennis. I stand up. My limbs feel heavy. I have to go.
Where?
Home. She won't be home for hours yet, but I need to be there when she arrives. I need to think about what I'm going to say. He nods, understanding.
Call me?
Yeah. I wait for Mom in the living room with my phone in my hands. I text her. Are you working a double tonight?
No, she texts back a few minutes later. Be home by 9.
I don't know whether to be relieved or even more anxious. When I close my eyes, I'm on the court of a tennis stadium. But instead of fans in the stands, each blue plastic seat holds another question or disturbing possibility or smiling stranger from the photos. And the rows of seats are endless, climbing toward the sky with no exits anywhere. Reaching past Mom's box, still on the coffee table, I grab the TV remote. I scroll by road through the saved programs on the DVR and select one of the old broadcasts of the U.S. Open. I save all the women's matches from the quarterfinals through the finals and rewatch whenever I'm stressed or feeling down or need a distraction. The sounds and rhythm of the matches are soothing, like a lullaby, and watching the players in all their glory always lifts my spirits and gets my head back on straight. Watch, learn, and then go practice some more. The DVR is nearly full with the recordings, so each week my mom has to watch her own shows immediately and then delete them in order to make room for whatever is scheduled to record in the coming days. She wanted to change cable companies last year, and I wouldn't let her, because I couldn't bear to return the box and give up these files. But right now, even the thrill of the edge of your seat 2015 semifinals match between Serena Williams and Roberta Vinci can't take my mind off reality. I love this match because I never know how to feel watching it. Serena is my hero, and I always want her to be number one. But there's also something so infectious about underdog Roberta's excitement and awe that she's winning the match. You can't help but root for her, too. It's the perfect example of how tennis can get inside your bones and make you feel a million feelings at once. How, despite the odds or the public's expectations, anyone, with hard work, skill, and desire, can make it to the top. Today, though, the shapes and colors flicker across the screen, but I don't really see them. The what-ifs and scenarios in my mind are too loud, too overbearing. 3 hours later.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.